A grand oak stands quietly at the corner of the Connellsville High School track. Having survived decades of political change and having flourished despite circumstances that challenged its very existence, the trees were presented to gold medal winners in the 1936 Berlin Games. This one was presented to a young African American who in less than 2 minutes did his part to dispel the notion of Aryan supremacy in the face of Adolf Hitler and his Nazi regime. He carried the sapling back from Germany and planted it in his hometown. That young man was John Huey Woodruff. His is one of only four known to remain in the United States. Over time, this tree has grown to represent the power of sports as a platform for racial equality and social change.
This is a story about a man, his tree, and the roots of using athletics in a quest for opportunity, fairness, and justice.
My name is John Woodruff, and I was born in a small town about 50 miles south of Pittsburgh. The name of this town is Connellsville, Pennsylvania. Just a small town right in the mountains.
Being in a small town, being in the middle of the Depression, you know, the small town seemed to be hit harder. Similar to other major American cities, there was a struggle financially. A struggle in terms of the demographic shape. People couldn't get loans to buy houses. You're looking at a time in the 1930s, in America in the 1930s, you're still dealing with an overtly racist society. So you have semblances of Jim Crow.
Growing up on a hill overlooking a rail yard on the banks of the Youghiogheny River, Woodruff watched his father labor in the coal mines and coke ovens that dominated the economy of the region, as his mother did day's work for local families. Silas and Sarah Woodruff both were the children of freed slaves. Woodruff's paternal grandfather, Wyatt Woodruff, and maternal grandfather, Wilson Henry, were both born into slavery.
A lot of African Americans look at their personal achievement as some way of acknowledging their ancestors, of saying, regardless of the fact that you were enslaved, we've made it. You know, we've come this far. And I think that that was not lost on John Woodruff whatsoever.
Few can speak to a personal relationship with John Woodruff during the height of Woodruff's success. One who can is 99-year-old Herb Douglas, the oldest living American Olympic medalist, having won bronze in the long jump at the 1948 Games.
Well, I was running track, and this long, tall guy, you know, he was 800-meter guy, 880 yards. That's what we ran during that time. And I would say that Johnny Woodruff would tell you something. You could put a nail in it. You could put it because he would just not talk to be talking. And that's why I admired him so.
Woodruff burst onto the track scene in high school, earning recognition in 1935 by setting the national high school mile record at 4 minutes, 23.4 seconds.
And what really developed John, he was a high school great. And he went up that hill where he lives. And going up hills develops athletes.
He went to the University of Pittsburgh on an athletic scholarship.
From an administrative end, it was just unheard of giving African-American scholarships back in the 1930s. And as I researched further, University of Michigan had the same problem.
Well, the opportunities were very nil. That was Jim Crow time. First Reconstruction, you know, they had that. Then Jim Crow came in. And
so Woodruff was a pioneer at Pitt. There were just a handful before John Woodruff.
That was the only way that I could go to college, was through athletics. My parents didn't have the money to send me to school. I had exactly 25 cents in my pocket when I entered the University of Pittsburgh.
I mean, it's daunting when you look at what it costs, you know, to attend college today with a quarter in your pocket. You know, that's a lesson for today's college students.
Throughout his life, John Woodruff prioritized athletics as a means to an education. Today, Connellsville High School senior Kyron Craigett also runs to forward his future of a college education through athletics.
I was always like fast, but like track showed me what fast was.
Hi, my name is Kyron Craigett, transferred to Connellsville sophomore year.
You gotta be competitive in football, you gotta be competitive in track too. Basically, it all just came together and worked. You want to win so much, like, you feel you got to like, go all out. Like, everything's on me, so like, if I lose, it's because of me.
Whoever gets themselves involved in athletics, you know, there's a lot of tremendous lessons that you can learn from that. Those lessons can be passed on in every high school, every college.
Being involved in athletics, it already starts the platform for confidence, for leadership, that platform for you to look inside yourself and figure out what you're made of.
And your first place calls away.
You actually want to do something. Like, you don't want to be not going to school and stuff. Like, you actually want to like be working on your academics so I can be able to go to colleges and stuff and actually like pursue my dreams.
That was the showcase for Nazi Germany. They carried over their political propaganda into the Berlin Games. And that could not have been comfortable for American Jewish athletes or African American athletes.
You're looking at this huge venue thinking that there were athletes who were basically tormented to be here, but yet they had to compete at the highest level.
One of the things that was prominent in the global discourse about race in the early part of the 20th century was just the basic idea of black athletic inferiority, right? The assumption was that there weren't any black athletes who were as good as any of the best white athletes.
You always had to wonder about the psychology of the American athletes being in that environment.
What were they thinking? And, you know, how did they, you know, the booing, the jeering, you know, the things that made them know, we don't want you here.
They're only a couple of generations removed from enslavement in this country. Again, puts another sort of frame around their achievement, that they've been able to come that far.
In the 1930s, the United States had a sense of its moral superiority. Right? You got the Nazis taking over in Germany. The United States has a sense of moral superiority. Let's confront the world with what Hitler represents. Let's confront the world with what Nazism represents.
So America had an opportunity to have the red, white, and blue fly on the gold medal stand in the Berlin Olympics, and they were not going to walk away from that.
And so there's Hitler, thinking that the world is a great place because of the ideology of Aryan supremacy. And here's the US State Department, here's the US Olympic Committee saying, look at it, right? Here is this truth that you are unwilling to see in order to preserve the mythology on which your social order is predicated.
America knew it had a great team. How were we going to react to the politicizing of these games on a daily basis, not knowing that we're just a few short years away from disaster in Europe?
What we did, we destroyed his master race theory,
that only the pure Germans could do certain things in this world. But we destroyed his theory whenever we start winning those gold medals.
As an African American, John Woodruff came further in life than anyone in the 800 meter finals just to get to the starting line. When the gun sounded, he would have to run further than anyone else on the track to win.
It was a great race. I mean, you know, when we see it decades later on film, it's a remarkable feat for him.
Woodruff, you know, didn't know he was just going to outrun everybody if he had to double them. If they had 10 yards on him, he was going to catch them.
Woodruff started off pretty good. You know, great pace. Wasn't in leading the pack or anything like that. But then was blocked in and cut off so that it was difficult for him to make his move.
Woodruff found himself boxed in by his competitors, who seemed to deliberately keep a slower pace. He feared that if he tried to force his way out, he would be disqualified for bumping another athlete.
And even a great fear for him was not so much that he would bump someone else, but they would bump him, but he would get blamed for the bump.
Yeah, being African-American, it was very easy for that to happen, so, yeah.
His strategy at that point, it was just basically survival. In the middle of a race, what can I do?
But he had to do something, and fast. It was a split-second choice of maybe win or definitely lose.
He just about stopped.
He's a world class in the Olympic Games. Everybody's a champion in this race. That you actually pretty much stop.
And what did he do? He just ran around all of them like they were standing still. And he hadn't reached his peak.
For that, something like, you gotta be a dynamic athlete. And tremendous courage too. A lot of people say, well, I'm boxed in. I can't do anything about it. I'll quit. So he was lucky coming out of that turn and sprinting to the finish.
With a nearly 10-foot stride, Long John Woodruff moved from almost last to a fighting chance.
And he had to actually run further than anyone else in that race because he had to go outside of the pack at least 2 or 3 yards to the right of the other runners.
He breezes past the field and sets his sights on the leader.
He's really going in that third gear, and going in that fourth gear, you're tired.
For about 9 seconds, he finally runs free.
He was able to make up, you know, the deficit he had and just poured it on.
So to come back and come to a complete stop and get in a full sprint to win something like that, that's amazing.
Bowing his chest and breaking the tape at 1 minute 52.9 seconds, an Olympic champion.
He ran further than anyone in that race in order to win.
And I always will believe that he felt as though he should have won and he was going to win, and that's what he did. When you stand up there on a podium and the national anthem is played, it's hard to hold back tears.
Everything happened so fast. In fact, I was quite nervous when I got up on the stand to receive my medal. Somewhere later, they presented a little oak tree, which I brought back home.
You're representing the country number one, but who else are you representing? You're representing your race.
And to knowing that I have achieved something, not just in the race, but against this racist regime. You know, it's sort of where you can parade your Nazi swastikas and all this stuff around and have this dictator sitting there. But if they're not coming in first place, then it kind of flies in the face of your supremacy ideas.
To be one generation removed from slavery, then suddenly becoming a recognized athletic talent, then flying half across the world and winning medals in front of Hitler's eyes, just had to be extraordinary.
The accomplishments of the 18 African Americans who competed in the 1936 Olympics, including 9 who won gold medals, led by Jesse Owens, who won 4 events, helped further pave the way for opportunities for Black athletes in America.
Those 9 African American athletes who won medals in Berlin really had an impact to the degree to showing that African American sport and athletes are some of the greatest athletes in this country.
Once they were given a fair chance to succeed, they took advantage of it.
That 1936 Olympic team really was the foundation for everything that we would see in the future of sports in America.
A 17-year-old Jackie Robinson watched in California as his older brother Mac returned from the 36 games only to sweep the streets of Pasadena while wearing his USA Olympic sweatshirt.
Jackie Robinson's older brother was on the Olympic team, and he couldn't get a job after the Olympics.
So I can imagine that Mac's performance had a great impact on his little brother.
Jackie comes along later on, about 10 years later, and then eventually, doors begin to start opening up right after the war.
It was an era, I think, in American history where integration, racial integration, was the primary way of thinking through race politics.
America becomes used to seeing Black athletes achieve and recognizing that if you want to win, you got to have some integration in your team, in team sports.
Others came before them. Moses Fleetwood Walker played professional baseball in 1884. Jack Johnson became world heavyweight boxing champion in 1908. Still, the feats of the 1936 Olympic team were monumental. To follow was a wave of accomplishments by Black athletes. Joe Lewis, 1937. Jackie Robinson, 1947. Earl Lloyd, 1950. Althea Gibson, 1956. Charlie Sifford, 1961. Madeline Manning Mims, 1968. Along with a string of seminal moments, Black athletes also increasingly use their public platform to draw attention to injustice and racism. Boxing champion Muhammad Ali, arguably the greatest global sports activist of all time, in 1967 refused to be drafted into the U.S. military. Another prominent Muslim, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, refused to play basketball in the 1968 Olympics. A civil rights demonstration at those Olympic Games in Mexico City, however, would become forever ingrained in American history.
John Carlos, Tommy Smith.
The raised fist itself had been a kind of universal symbol of unity, frequently called the Black Power Salute, but for them it was just a symbol of unity.
It was the 2012 shooting death of Trayvon Martin in South Florida that sparked a renaissance in athlete activism.
You've got a convergence in the 20-teens between a change in the global media scape through the influence of social media, police violence becoming more visible through social media. You've got athletes going around traditional media and communicating directly with sports consumers, then gives rise to the new era of Black athlete activism, the renaissance of Black athlete activism.
Starting with Martin's death and continuing with the series of African Americans being shot and often killed by police, a wave of demonstrations and calls for social justice and change emerged. The Black Lives Matter movement was born, as were hashtag rally cries like, hands up, don't shoot, I can't breathe, and say their names.
a lot of these athletes are saying that we are not separate from society, that what happens to George Floyd very well happened to me. The fact is that I have a responsibility.
We all have to take part in it. It's not going to happen overnight. It's not going to happen as quickly as we would like for it to happen.
I just don't think that American society is organized in such a way that athletes are going to end police violence. The thing that will end police violence is when police stop shooting.
We still have racism in this country. This country is still full of racism as far as a black man is concerned. And to date, things have gotten much better, but we still have a long way to go.
He was really young when he did what he did, you know, and achieve what he achieved. Would he face the same type of discrimination that your average African-American would face? The answer is yes. Segregation still existed.
John Woodruff was left behind in Pittsburgh in 1937 when segregation laws in Maryland prevented him from competing at the U.S. Naval Academy. He later had a world record stripped when Texas officials ruled the track was 6 feet short. The racist incident stung him deeply.
He just felt he did something he had to do. When you go through high school winning races, and then you go to college winning races, and then you go to the world epitome of winning races.
I think that he felt that there was something he could contribute to change America.
After the Olympics, John Woodruff never lost on the track again. He earned a master's degree from New York University in 1941 and entered military service, serving in World War II and Korea, ending his athletic career in its prime.
John Woodruff, to me, stands out as one of the great American sports heroes, and his race is exemplary of what you are taught in this country if you're an athlete, the type of determination you're supposed to have, the will you're supposed to have, and the class you're supposed to have.
The world lost the last member of the 1936 U.S. Olympic track team when Woodruff died in October 2007 at age 92. But the importance of what he and others accomplished in Berlin has carried on over the decades, both in the legacy of his tree and the opportunities afforded generations of black athletes.
I have often wondered just how far I really ran that day, Woodruff once said. Far, John, far.
I can imagine that every child in Connellsville between the grades of K through 12 are continually introduced to that oak tree and the meaning of that tree so that they could become a part of it and it could become a part of who they are.
I'm at practice one day, whatever, and then they talk about the tree. And he's like, there's like a big history on the tree. I'm like, all right, that's nice. And then he's telling me like how he actually got it and stuff, and I'm like, oh, that's pretty like cool.
He brought that tree back from where, the Olympics? He didn't put it in his backyard. He gave it to where it should go, to influence other kids.
The fact that it's still around, and I mean, great that it was an oak, because oak trees last for a long time. To see that there are at least four that still exist in the United States means that they're at least being cared for and recognized and appreciated.
That tree is a representation of, you know, the freedom to grow, the freedom to be wherever you want to be, the freedom to be planted and have the right to grow.
One of the reasons to appreciate the endurance of those trees as symbols for athlete activism is that there has always been a common impulse to activism, but the direction of that activism has shifted and changed over time and moves in different directions at the same time as part of the same tradition.
I think that it's a symbol of what he, you know, visually represented was determination, but it also represents a great foundation for that community. That oak tree represents something greater than themselves.
And I think sports has done so much in order to make the country a better country in terms of social relationships between peoples. And that's what the Olympics does, you know. There was very definitely a spatial feeling in winning the gold medal and being a black man. So I was very proud of that achievement. And I was very happy for myself as an individual, for my race, and for my country.